Welcome to GYAS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel, we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services. And for that purpose, we have started multiple MCQ series on our channel, which we will focus your prelims of 2019. So what we are doing, friends, earlier what we used to do, we used to upload daily six series of six topics. And in each series, the five questions of each topic was covered. But from now onwards, what we are doing, we are covering 30 questions of each topic, and to each topic we are allotting a day. So for example, earlier what was the case of geography, so you daily used to get daily five questions of geography. In this manner, you used to get questions in a week, that is 5 into 6 30. So now we will allot a particular day to a particular topic, and 30 questions will be covered. So there is no big change, only the change is that you will not be getting separate lectures. You will be getting a complete lecture, and the lecture will now be quite longer. So let's start our discussion of today's lecture. So first question is, which of the following factors may affect air circulation? First is density of air, second is air temperature, third is air pressure, fourth is height of air column. So we have to select the correct answer using the code below. So friends, as you know that density of air, where the air is denser, it tries to disperse. So obviously density of air has the effect. So it subsides. The denser air subsides and the lighter air moves upwards. So air circulation is affected by density of air. Regarding air temperature, yes friends, this also affects the air circulation because the higher the temperature of the air, the lighter it is. So it will lead to lower pressure where the air temperature is high. So certainly second is also right. Third is also right, friends. Air pressure, where the pressure is high, the wind tends to disperse outwards and towards the low pressure area. Fourth is regarding height of air column. Yes friends, this also affects your air circulation because the jet streams that are at an altitude of 2 to 3 kilometers in troposphere, they affect the lower air circulation. So yes, they also affect. So all of the above is the correct answer of this question. So the solution is D. So let's see what is the solution. So the solution is D. So here is the explanation. When air is heated, it expands and becomes lighter and goes up, and cold air is denser and heavy, and lighter air tends to rise and denser air tends to sink. So first statement is correct. Regarding second statement, temperature is one of the most important factors affecting the density. The higher the temperature of the air, lesser will be its density. So obviously it affects. Air pressure is also affects it. Where the higher the pressure is there, if a particular area has higher air pressure, then certainly the air will move towards the low air pressure. So statement 3 is also correct. Regarding the higher air columns that are 2 to 8 kilometers in troposphere, that is jet streams, they also affect these air circulation patterns. So they have a particular circulation pattern. So statement 4 is also correct. So learning is, when hot air rises, cold air from surrounding areas rushes to fill in the gap. That is how air circulation takes place. This can be affected by factors as mentioned above. So let's move on to second question, friends. The second question is, consider the following characteristics. So first statement is, this layer is free from clouds and other weather conditions. It is ideal for flying aeroplanes. Third is, it protects us from the harmful effect of sun rays. So we have been asked about which layer we are talking about. So let me tell you friends that clouds are not formed in stratosphere. So this obviously it is ideal for flying aeroplanes also, and ozone layer is also present there, and it prevents us from harmful UV rays, harmful effect of sun rays. So the correct solution is D. So friends, here from now onwards I will provide you only the solution, because the explanation will be provided only to the our subscribers who have subscribed to the explanation PDFs. I will not provide the explanation PDFs here. Why I have included the explanation of first question, so that you might get idea that whether we are following the pattern of UPSC or not, in case you are seeing our video for the first time, so that you can get an idea that whether we are following the pattern
question or not. You will slowly, as we go, we will cover you, the questions. You will see the pattern of the level of questions that we have included. So this is about second statement regarding explanation. Explanation will not be provided to you people. Sorry, friends, you have to subscribe for that. So obviously, the reason behind this is that obviously we are also certainly working for a motivation. So that is the purpose of keeping it private. Third is why is air filled in special protective suits of the astronauts visiting moon. So sometimes you might have seen the photograph of an astronaut standing on a moon. So he appears kind of that like the air is filled in his dress. So why it is so? So A option is there is no air and thus no air pressure at moon to protect them from the extreme heat on the surface of moon. C is to overcome the effect of gravity on body fluid circulation. T is to save themselves from harmful radiation coming from the moon. So friends, let me tell you that the correct answer is A. That is, there is no air and thus no air pressure at moon. But friends, what is the scenario in Earth? There is air that continuously exerts our pressure on our body. So in response to it, our blood vessels also expand, exert pressure on our body, and kind of there is an equilibrium between the pressure exerted by the blood and by the air outside our body that surrounds us. So there is a balance, but in case of moon there is no air, so obviously our body will continue to pump the blood and the blood will obviously exert pressure on the wings, but if in case there is no counter pressure of air, then certainly the wings will burst and the astronaut will start bleeding. So that's why the A option is correct. So the solution is A and explanation is available only to the subscribers who have subscribed to it. So let's move on to the fourth question. Westerlies and easterlies are A is seasonal winds, B is local winds confined to the equator, C is permanent winds, D is trade winds. So let me tell you friends that you might have heard about these, and this is a very easy question that I have included. So friends, these are basically permanent winds. Permanent winds are those winds that remain there on the surface of Earth for all around the year. So seasonal winds are those that reverse their direction, but permanent winds do not reverse their direction and they flow in a particular direction only. Local winds are those that remain confined to a particular region, for example Louis in Punjab. So trade winds are not westerlies and easterlies. Trade winds are actually those winds that flow in tropical regions. Westerlies and easterlies flow in beyond the subtropics, that is in temperate areas. So the solution is they are permanent winds. So the fourth answer to this is C. So let's move on to your fifth question. The fifth question is the correct order of increasing distribution of water on Earth is. So friends, here we have been asked that what is the correct order of distribution of water on Earth. So the options are rivers, atmosphere, salt lake, groundwater and ice caps. B, groundwater, atmosphere, salt lakes, river, ice caps. So there is no value of explaining here because already the solution is given before you. So the correct order is of increasing distribution of water is rivers, then atmosphere, then salt lakes, then groundwater, then ice cap. Friends, let me tell you that the highest water is contained in the largest amount of water is found in oceans, and after that comes the ice caps. At last comes the rivers. So at second last number comes the atmosphere. So friends, the solution is A. So here is a table which I have included, so you can see it. Here is oceans have 97.3% of water and it is saline water, but the fresh water is only in ice caps, groundwaters, freshwater lakes and salt lakes and atmosphere and rivers, and thus we have only very fresh water that is available to you for drinking purposes. Also, the water of ice caps is not available for us to drink for drinking purposes because it is frozen there. So this is about the explanation part. So I have provided you in between. I will provide you the explanation so that you can get an idea that whether we are following the pattern of UPSC or not. In case if you are interested to subscribe to these explanation PDFs, then you can do so. I will tell you the procedure later on. So let's move on to the next question. Sixth question is why are tsunamis relatively rare in Indian Ocean as compared to the Pacific Ocean? So here we have been asked that why the tsunamis are rare in Indian Ocean. First is average wave height in Indian Ocean is shorter than in the Pacific Ocean. Second is seismic activity is less compared as to the Pacific. So friends, let me tell you that there is no relation of wave height and tsunami. Yes, the height makes the tsunami severe, but average that doesn't explain that why in Indian Ocean the tsunamis doesn't happen. Tsunamis happen basically due to seismic activities. So the seismic activity in Indian Ocean is less as compared to Pacific Ocean. And that's why the tsunamis are relatively rare in Indian Ocean as compared to Pacific Ocean. So the correct answer is second only. Second statement only, that means the B option. So the solution is B. So this is the solution, and the explanation will be provided to you in the explanation PDF. So let's move on to your seventh question. Neap tides occur when? Neap tide occurs when, friends, here also when sun, moon and earth are in same line. Sun, moon and earth form a circle. Sun, moon and earth form a right angle triangle. D is earth is centered between sun and moon. So let me tell you, friends, that the solution is C. The neap tide, that is the low tide, it occurs when the sun, moon and earth are at right angles. When they are in line with each other, then the formation of tides that takes place are called spring tides. They are also referred to as high tides. So when they are in same line, then it forms spring tide. So A is not the answer. Obviously A is wrong, because when they are in same line, then the formation of spring tide take place. Actually they when they are at right angle, then the formation of neap tide occurs. So here I have included a pic for it, you can see it. So here is the image of neap tide. So you in neap tide you can see that here it is at right angle, but in spring tide the earth, moon and sun are in same line. So this leads to spring tide. Spring tide is also known as high tide, and neap tide is also known as low tide. So let's move on to the next question. The eighth question is, consider the following. First is foggy weather. Second is high biological productivity. Third is plentiful fish catch. So here we have been asked that the above are associated with which of the following. A is intertidal zones, B meeting of warm and cold currents, C marine upwelling zones, D shallow seas. Friends, let me tell you that how high biological productivity takes place in intertidal zones, but they do not have foggy weather. So that's why A is not the option. But in case of B, meeting of warm and cold currents, yes friends, this is the answer. Because where the meeting of the warm and cold current takes place, the foggy weather takes place, and also there the biological productivity is quite high, and also there is plentiful fish catch there. For example, the meeting of Labrador current and Gulf Stream in Atlantic Ocean leads to the foggy weather and high biological productivity, as well as plentiful fish catch. So the correct option is D. So the solution is B. So let's see about the solution. So the solution is B, and the explanation will be provided only to our subscribers only. So if you want to become a subscriber, then you can become. There is no limitation in that, and no restriction to become that. Ninth question is, Ladakh, a cold desert in Great Himalayas, is enclosed by. So as the solution is before you, so obviously clearly the solution is A, that is Karakoram Range in north and Zanskar Range in south. So the Ladakh region is basically a cold desert that is in the Greater Himalayas. It is enclosed on the northwards by the Karakoram Range, and in towards the south by Zanskar Range. So here I have included a diagram also. So you can see the Karakoram Range is above here. So Karakoram Range, and then comes Ladakh, that is the cold desert, and after that comes the Zanskar Range. So Zanskar Range is here, and here is Pir Panjal. So Pir Panjal is below this Karakoram, and in between Karakoram and Zanskar comes the Ladakh desert, that is the cold desert. So this is, and now at the last comes the Pir Panjal range. So here in diagram you can see here also the Shivalik range is here. So this is about your question. So let's move on to the next question. 10th question is, in season of retreating monsoon, wind blows from. So here this is also a quite easy question, so you will be able to answer this, friends. Here the question is, in the case of retreating monsoon, wind blows from A, Arabia Sea and Bay of Bengal towards the India land, B, the Indian mainland towards Bay of Bengal and Southeast India, C, the Indian mainland towards Southwest India, D, the Southeast India to Western Indian mainland. So let me tell you, friends, that the correct answer is that the blowing of the wind, it is the when wind blows from Indian mainland towards Bay of Bengal and Southeast Asia, because A is the case of incoming monsoons. The A statement, that is the winds blowing, wind blows from Arabian, when winds blow from Arabian Sea and Bay of Bengal towards Indian land, then it brings monsoon. It is not retreating monsoon, it is coming monsoon. It is the coming of monsoons. So B is the correct answer. The retreating monsoon is associated with blowing of the winds from Bay of Bengal, from Indian mainland to the Bay of Bengal and Southeast India. So the solution here is B. So this is about your 10th question. Let's move on to the next question, the 11th question. Which of the following are examples of fold mountains? First is Ural Mountains. Second is Appalachians, North America, that is Mount Kilimanjaro, Africa. So is Vosges Mountain, Europe. So we have to choose the correct answer using the codes below. So let me tell you, friends, that the correct answer is A, that is Ural Mountains, Russia, and Appalachians in North America, because Mount Kilimanjaro is not the right answer. Why Mount Kilimanjaro is not the right option? Because friends, Mount Kilimanjaro is a volcanic mountain, as is visible on your screen. Explanation, the statement 3 is wrong, and Vosges Mountain is a block mountain. So first and two, Ural Mountain is an old fold mountain in Russia, and Appalachians are young fold mountains in North America. So they are fold mountains. So explanation in detail that what are fold mountains and what are other things, they are provided to the to our paid subscribers only. 12th question is, what would happen if the earth revolved around the sun, did not rotate? So as you know that earth, friends, now rotate as well as revolve around the sun. But here we have been asked that what would happen if it stopped rotating. So if, for example, if it did not rotate, the first is South Pole would always be in darkness. Second, half of the population living in equator would freeze out of cold. Third is heat and wind circulation on earth will be affected. Friends, let me tell you that first is not the right statement, because how it could happen, the darkness part is associated with the revolution of earth. So with rotation, the day and night happens. So if the earth doesn't rotate, a particular portion of earth would remain always sunlit and other part will always remain in darkness. So but this is not the case that South Pole would always remain be in darkness. South Pole will experience 6 months long day and 6 months long night. So first is incorrect, second is also incorrect. The half of the population living on equator would freeze out. This is not the case. But third option is correct. Heat and wind circulation on earth will be affected, because only one part of the earth will be facing the sun. So in that case, the wind circulation will also be affected. So the answer is third only. So solution is B. So here is the solution. So I have explained to you already in great detail. If you want to further see, then here is a diagram, so you can from diagram you can clarify your doubts further. And if further explanation you want, then you have to subscribe for an initiative. 13 is, if you do not have a GPS, you can still know latitude of your place by A, measuring angle of pole star from your place, B, measuring the angle between the pole star and big deeper constellation from your place, C, looking at the direction of your compass, D, none of the above. So friends, let me tell you that that the latitude is basically the latitude of your place is basically the angle that your place makes with the center of the earth. So friends, as the pole star is directly above the north pole, so if you know the angle between your north pole and you know the angle between your north pole and you, then you can subtract from 90 that angle, and then you will get you the latitude, the angle of your latitude. So basically the solution is A, that is measuring angle of pole star from your place. Let's move on to the 14th question. 14th question is, apart from carbon dioxide, rain can become acidic due to which of the following? So friends, it is quite easy question, because it is a simple concept. First is presence of lead in air, second is sulfur dioxide, third nitrogen dioxide, fourth carbon monoxide. So we have to choose the correct code options using the codes below. Let me tell you, friends, that lead doesn't mix with water, so there is no effect of rainfall. There is no relation between lead and acidic rain. the lead is eliminated. Regarding carbon monoxide also doesn't react. It reacts with water at high temperatures. So the options that are left are second and third. This and also the carbon dioxide leads to acid rain. So the carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide, nitrogen dioxide, what happens? They mix with the rainwater and they form sulfuric acid, nitric acid, and carbonic acid, which causes rainfall. So the correct answer is two and three only. That is the B. So solution is B. So in detail explanation is here, but you cannot get it. 15th question is, consider the following statements. Excessive use of chemical fertilizers makes the soil basic. Second is, if the soil is basic, organic matter is added to rejuvenate it. Friends, so we have been asked to choose the answer. So let me tell you, friends, that the excessive use of chemical fertilizers actually makes the soil acidic and not make it basic. So the first statement is clearly wrong. Regarding the second statement, if the soil is basic, organic matter is added to rejuvenate it. Yes, it is correct, because organic matter, when it decomposes, it releases acid, because it is acidic in nature. So the acidic nature neutralizes the basic nature of the soil, and in this way soil fertility is restored and ideal conditions in soil are restored. So the answer is second only, that is the B. So the solution is B. So this is about your 15th question. Let's move on to the 16th question. How does ozone protect us from harmful ultraviolet radiation? So friends, here we have been asked that how it protects us from ultraviolet radiation. So the solution here is B. B, why B? Because it absorbs the UV radiation, breaking down into oxygen. So this ozone protects us by absorbing the UV radiation. It doesn't reflect it. It doesn't convert it in any form. It doesn't change its frequency. It simply absorbs the UV radiation, the ozone layer. Let's move on to the 17th question. The 17th question is, all changes in weather are ultimately caused by the. So here we have been asked that ultimately the weather changes that take place are caused by A, hydrological cycle on Earth; B, primordial heat inside the Earth; C, rotation of Earth; D, energy of the Sun. So let me tell you, friends, that hydrological cycle do decide the weather of your Earth, because it causes in the distribution of temperature. For example, rainfall, and also the ocean currents, they distribute the temperature of different places. They balance the temperature, but it doesn't have much effect. But in case of B, the primordial heat inside the Earth, it also doesn't affect your weather. Simply, what it does, it simply it decides the shape of your Earth, and it doesn't play role in the weather. So rotation of Earth has no role with weather, but the energy of Sun is the right answer, because because Sun is the primary source of energy, and all changes in weather take place due to Sun. Because where the sunrise will be high, where the sunrise intensity will be high, obviously the temperature of that place will be high, and obviously the air pressure would be low, and similarly the other weather events will be decided by it. So the weather is ultimately decided by energy of the Sun a particular place is receiving. Let's move on to your 18th question. 18th question is, which of the following will increase the strength of the cyclone? A, proximity to land surfaces; B, heat released from condensation of water vapor; C, absence of cloud formation; D, lowering temperature of sea water. So let me tell you, friends, that the proximity to land surface does not play any role, because in actual practice it leads to the decrease in strength of cyclone. A cyclone dies when it reaches the land surface. So it basically it needs moisture for its sustenance. So obviously the lack of moisture will obviously weak it will not strengthen it. Sec B is heat released from condensation of water vapor. Yes, friends, this is an important fact that strengthens the cyclone. Why C and D are not correct? Because C, absence of cloud formation. If there is no cloud formation, then obviously the strength of cyclone will be low. There will be no intensity in the cyclone. So C is also not the case. And lowering temperature of seawater, what will it cause? It will cause the lesser evaporation and lesser moisture to the cyclone. And obviously the cyclone is based on the moisture. So the moisture is available to it by the heat. So heat, when it is released from condensation of water vapors, so this heat, when it is released, it heats the adjoining area. So when it hits the adjoining area, the air adjoining it move upwards, and the cooler air, the cold air tends to come in the place of that air that has been moved up. So in this way, the wind start blowing towards a particular center, creating a cyclonic condition. So this is about the cyclone. So it is, the strength depends upon the heat released from the condensation of water vapor. So let's move on to your 19th question. 19th question is, India does not produce large amounts of gold. Which of the following of these can be the possible reasons? So some gold mines in India are very deep, which makes its commercial extraction expensive. Second, India's gold reserves are highly scarce. Third is, technological barriers exist and extraction is risky. So friends, let me tell you that first statement is correct, that some gold mines in India are very deep, which makes commercial extraction expensive. So that's why there is very less venture in this case. So all it, we meet the maximum amount of our needs, more than 99% of our needs of gold from imports. Actually, there are gold reserves are there in India, for example in Kolar in Karnataka. So but the Kolar mines are also one of the deepest mines in the world. So working conditions become there extremely difficult. So also friends, regarding the second is not correct, because India has gold reserves. India has 9% of the total global gold reserves. So it is not the case that gold reserves are scarce in India. So it is not the correct statement. Regarding third statement, it is correct, because there are technological barriers. There is not enough technology at currently at disposal to extract gold from such deep mines. So 1 and 3 is the correct answer. That is, solution is C. So this is all about your 19th question. Let's move on to the 20th question. Which of the following can be done using Earth observation satellites? So here we have been asked that what you can do by Earth observation satellites. First is crop production forecast. Second is snow and glacier studies. Third is ocean primary productivity. Fourth is landslide hazard zonation. Fifth is site selection for hydropower. So friends, let me tell you that all these activities are done by using Earth observation satellite. So friends, how? Because obviously if there is green cover, then obviously you can see that the crop production is, the green cover is basically due to plants and plantations, so obviously you can forecast the crop production. Also, if there are, the image is white, you can tell that there is snow and glacier there. So if there are patches of green color in between the blue color, then obviously you can tell that there is phytoplankton there, that is the ocean's primary producers. So you can tell this also. Also you can do the landslide hazard zonation. And also fifth is right, that the site selection can be done for hydropower. So all of the above are correct. So the correct answer is D. Let's move on to your 21st question. So here is a detail that what could be done using Earth remote satellites. So tele-education, tele-medicine, panchayat planning, training, weather information, marketing, drinking water, watershed development, all such things can be done. So let's move on to the 21st question. 21st question is, consider the following statements. It is the largest coastal lagoon in India. It is the largest wintry ground for migratory birds on Indian subcontinent. It was designated the first Indian wetland of international importance under the Ramsar Convention. Next is, the lake has numerous islands. So friends, we have to choose the correct, the above statement refers to. A is Dronika Lake, second B Chilka Lake, C Kuleru Lake, D Sambar Lake. So friends, let me tell you that the first lake that was designated as a wetland of international importance under Ramsar was Chilka Lake. So the answer is Chilka Lake, that is B. So it is the largest coastal lagoon in India, and also it is the largest wintering ground in India. So this is the option. So solution is B. So explanation is provided to the to our subscribers. 22nd question is, consider the following conditions. First is moderate rainfall, second moderate temperature, third presence of sunshine, fourth well-drained fertile soils. So here we have been asked that regarding which above conditions are required for the growth of which crop. So here we have been asked that regarding the which crop the conditions are ideal. So let me tell you friends that in case of rice and maize, the rice cannot be the answer because rice requires high temperature and high rainfall. And also in case of jute, the high temperature and high rainfall is required. In case of wheat and maize, in case of cotton is not also the right answer because it can survive in less rainfall. So also the D is not the answer, C is not the answer. So the right answer is solution is B, that is wheat and maize. So basically wheat requires while its sowing takes place, it requires moderate rainfall, but when its harvest takes place, it requires presence of sunshine and moderate temperature and well-drained loamy fertile soil it needs. So this is about your 22nd question. Let's move on to 23rd question. 23rd question is where is 23rd question? Oh sorry, 23rd question is 23rd question is missing friends, sorry. Oh, here is a typing error, so I forgot to underline it. So 23rd question is, if we draw the population pyramid of a country, which of the following information cannot be obtained from it? A, dependency ratio. B, whether the population is growing, stable or decreasing. C, the distribution within the population. D, the total population size. So friends, let me tell you that when in case of if we draw population pyramid, we can tell the dependency ratio, but we can't tell the population size. That is, the solution is D. So here is a population pyramid, you can see about it. Here is the population pyramid in which you can see the dependency ratio and the size of population that is in different age groups, but you can't measure the exact population size. So D is the answer. So let's move on to your next question. Which of these areas are not industrial regions? Manila, Santiago, third Nairobi, fourth Manchuria, fifth Maybud. So we have to choose the answer using the codes below. A is 1, 2, 3, B is 2, 3 and 4, C is 4 and 5, and D is 5 only. I repeat the question, which of the following areas are not industrial regions? Manila, Santiago, Nairobi, Manchuria, Maybud. So let me tell you friends that the solution is D. Only the fifth is not the industrial region because it is a village and not an industrial region. Rest all are industrial regions. So here I have included a pic. I will show you diagram. So here is the image of that particular. You can see the image here that these are the various industrial regions of Earth. So this has been picked up from the NCERT of your NCERT of 7th class, industrial regions, very different industrial regions. So here that are the regions that have been docked are industrial regions. So here Northeast America, you can see that here Northeast America, and here the Northern Africa, and here the Eastern South America, and here the Western Europe and the Eastern Asia and the East Asia, and also this region, these regions are industrial regions. So let's move on to your 24th question. 24th question is, consider the following statements about IT policy in India. The first is, the latest IT policy was launched in 2008. Second is, the first state government to announce an IT policy was Karnataka in 1997. So friend, you might be thinking that why this question has been asked in geography. Let me tell you friend that this is a part of your economic geography. You people read human geography or economic geography, concentration of particular industry in a particular region. So that comes under your geography. So that's why this question has been included in your geography part. So let me tell you that the latest IT policy was not launched in 2008 but in 2012. So clearly the first statement is wrong. The second is, the first state government to announce an IT policy was Karnataka in 1997. So friends, yes, this is correct. The second statement is correct. Because why at present the Bengaluru has the highest, we can say the leading hub of, we also say the Bengaluru as a Silicon Valley of India. So why it is so called? Because Karnataka was the first state that introduced the IT policy. So that's why the Bengaluru emerged as a hub of IT industry in India. So there are also multiple reasons other also, so that they are available in explanation PDF. 25th question is, to improve productivity without the use of fertilizers, organic farming relies on first plant growth regulator, second nanomaterials, third genetically modified organisms. So here we have been asked that to improve the productivity without the use of fertilizers, that organic farming relies on which things. So friends, let me tell you that there is no chemical used in it. So obviously the no technology is used in it. We use traditional things. So obviously third is directly eliminated. There is no genetic modification of or modification of organisms. So let me tell you that the solution of this answer is D. That is none of the above, because nanomaterials are also there is no kind of, we can say, nanomaterial. How can we use the nanomaterial in case of organic farming? Regarding the first statement also, friends, you doesn't regulate the growth, a plant growth in it. Basically you take it to happen organically, so you allow the nature to evolve it by itself. So the option is none of the above. Let's move on to your next question. The next question is 26th. Consider the following statements. Migrants from other countries in India are more than intrastate migrants in India. Second is, annual immigration in India is more than the number of Indian diaspora abroad. So friends, if you read newspaper or if you have some general idea about India, then you can certainly say that second statement is clearly wrong, because Indian diaspora abroad is much bigger in size as compared to annual immigration into India. So immigration into India is very less because India is not that much developed. India's diaspora does reside in the various Western countries. Regarding the first statement, friends, first statement is also incorrect, because the intrastate migrants in India are more as compared to migrants from other countries. So the solution is D, that is none. So you can see the solution is D. So this is all about your question. So you can see here a diagram. So total population, the data is from basically census 2001. So here you can see the diagram. Next is 27th question. Flowing parallel to the contours of a hill slope from a natural barrier for water to flow down the slope is also known as. So friends, when you flow parallel to the contours of a hill slope, then what it is called? A, contour barriers. B, mulching. C, contour flowing. D, terrace farming. So let me tell you, friends, that the correct answer is contour plowing. This is known as contour plowing, when you plow parallel to the hill slope so as to avoid the soil erosion, so and also to check the soil erosion, and also to so that it these form a kind of barriers, these contour plowing in which crops become a kind of barrier to the soil to prevent it from seeping down. So the solution is C. So let's move on to your 28th question is, and here you can see the diagram of contour plowing. So here is the diagram I have included, so you can see it. So basically here if the farmer is plowing parallel to the slope, so in this case the slope in slope is this, so basically it is plowing not parallel, it is plowing perpendicular to the slope. So this is the case of with contour plowing. Next is, in India, tea is grown in which of the following regions? First is Dwars and Terai, second is Kangra, third is Travancore, fourth is Ongla. Let me tell you, friends, that the tea is grown in. We have to choose the correct answer, and and it is first is. Friends, hold on for a second. Yeah, friends, here let's start our discussion. The answer is first, second and third. That is Dwars and Terai, Kangra and Travancore. These are the regions where the tea grow. That, so the solution is 1, 2 and 3 only. That is the A. So where the tea grows, what are the ideal conditions? So friends, the ideal conditions you have to tell in the comment box. But let me also tell you that the ideal conditions are high rainfall, cold temperature and gentle slope, and there is a kind of loamy soil. So that these are the ideal conditions. So there is now no need of commenting in the comment box. Already I have told you the ideal condition for the tree growth. So let me provide you explanation. I have kind of starved you a lot for the explanation thing. So let me provide you for this question, so you can see that the Assam leads in the tea production, and that after comes the West Bengal, where also the conditions are quite cooler, and also there is quite well distributed rainfall throughout the year. So after that comes the regions that are like Tripura, Uttarakhand, Bihar, Manipur, Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh, Himachal Pradesh, Nagaland, Meghalaya, Mizoram, and Odisha. Basically, the Kangra region comes in Himachal Pradesh, and after that comes the Travancore. So this is the you can see the tree production. This is about the tree production. Assam is the single largest tree producer in India. So let's move on to your 29th question. Consider the following minerals. First is lead, antimony, tungsten, tin. So which of the following region is the leading producer of the above? So let me tell you, friends, that tin, the leading producer of tin is East and Southeast Asia. And also in case of lead and antimony and tungsten, the China leads. So obviously the answer is East and Southeast Asia. So the solution is C. So these are clear facts, so you have to just remember it. There is no solution of a kind of that why they are there, because obviously why they are leading producers. Obviously they are there found because that's why they are leading producers. So the solution is C. So explanation, let me provide you the explanation. This question: China, Malaysia, and Indonesia are among the world's leading tin producers, and China also leads in production of lead, antimony, and tungsten. So option C is correct. So let's move on to your last question. Consider the following statements about a tribal group. First is they mainly live in Odisha. Second is their native language is Kui, a Dravidian language. Third is they generally settle in higher altitudes due to their economic demands. So to which tribal group do the above refer to? So the A option is the Koles, B is the Gaddis, the C is Badagas, and D is the Khons. So you might question me that why such questions are asked, but friends, it is not my choice. It is a choice of UPSC. UPSC call you has the habit of asking about tribes, so that's why this question has been included. So it is about human geography. So let me tell you, friends, that this in this we are talking about the cones. So friends, this is all about your today's discussion. So friends, if you liked it, please like it, please share it with your other friends, and please comment if you have any suggestion. I will certainly consider your suggestion. And lastly, let me tell you that I was continuously saying that explanation is available only to the subscribers that have subscribed to our initiative. So that for that purpose, we have given you the explanation for only first question and of only few questions, because so that you can adjust the quality of our questions and their explanation. So friends, let me tell you that why it is important to get the explanation PDFs, because at the end of the day you will not be able to see 30 to 40-minute long video, because at that time you will have multiple topics to revise, and also at that time topics like newer topics will also be there to you people to cover. For example, economic survey, India yearbook, the budget, extra. So at that time there will be multiple topics, and they will not be covered through videos. And also at that time, when you if you started reading bulky books, bulky standard books or NCERTs, then it will become a waste of time, because at that time you can't read whole book. It also becomes lengthy, and it also becomes monotonous, because at that time you have to revise the concepts quickly and in a fast manner. So the best method is following the question and answer approach. So friends, let me clarify you that UPSC is not just about seeing a question and its answer. UPSC is much more than that. UPSC is about clearing your concepts and clearing your facts and remembering facts. And in this case, you must read also the explanation, that is why a particular option is correct and why the other three are incorrect, and in which correct context they will be correct. So that is the UPSC, which demands you from you people the concept clarity. So explanation, what happens, what it does, it basically keeps your interest at a high level. When you follow the question answer format, then you see the question and then you go for its answer. If your answer is wrong, then you go for explanation. In this way you keep on revising your concepts. And also friends, questions are framed from the angle of previous year pattern previous year exams of UPSC. So in this case, so you can revise the maximum concepts in a minimum time and without any loss of time, and also you will feel interested and feel motivated, and you will do the revision multiple times, and that is what is required in UPSC. The revision is the main thing that UPSC demands from you people, because the syllabus is quite vast and the revision is done rarely, and students keep on reading and they never do revision, and then they think that why they are not getting selected in UPSC. So please friends, do revise your concepts clearly. But in case, let me tell you the fee structure for it, the explanation PDFs. So friends, here is a fee structure. For environment, we are charging you people rupees 50. For ancient India it is 100, medieval India it is 100, modern 100. For geography it is 400, for polity it is 200. So let me tell you friends that this is not the cost of one PDF, it is the cost of entire PDFs that we will provide you till 31st May. So why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because your prelims of UPSC is on 2nd June, and we will end this series only one day before your prelims exam. So friends, all the PDFs that will be covered till 31st May, and all the PDFs that we have covered till date, you will get all of them in just this amounts. For example, in case of ancient India, you will get all the PDFs in just rupees 100. There is no need to pay. There is no need to make recurrent payments. It is a single time payment. So in rupees 100, you get all the PDFs of ancient India that we have covered and that we are going to cover. So you can imagine that how much questions you will be getting. Approximately 1000 questions of each topic you will be getting, and the subscription amount is the minimum that we have kept. So the total package is if you want to subscribe to the total package, then total amounts to 950, but the complete package is available to you at in rupees 800 in case you want to get the complete package. That is, we are giving you people a discount of rupees 150 on the complete package, and if you want to get it, then you can WhatsApp us at this number, that is 8968426481. So if you want to subscribe to our initiative, you can WhatsApp us at this number, it is 8968426481. So this is all about friends, today's lecture. Please like it, share it, and please friends, do subscribe to our channel, and do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications of the updates that we do on our YouTube channel relating to the UPSC CSE 2019. So thank you.